with this video, we'll conclude our exploration of the unique sacramental mode of Christ's presence in the Eucharist according to St. Thomas Aquinas. Now, we've already seen that Christ is present whole and entire in the Eucharist. He's present whole and entire under either species. He's present whole and entire in every part of either species. And he's even present whole and entire, including his dimensive quantity and all of his accidents. Now, we'll take that one further step and say that dimensive quantity and all of Christ's accidents are present in the Eucharist, but again, in a very, very unique way. And I would say in a very odd way, because it's different from the way those things are present in any other body around us. And this gives the Eucharist and Christ's presence some very strange properties. So let's look at this. So Thomas, in Article 5 of Question 76, in the third part of the Summa, says, Christ's body is in this sacrament, not after the proper manner of dimensive quantity, but rather after the manner of substance. So the dimensive quantity of Christ's body is present, Thomas says, but not in its proper manner, not in the same way that it's present in everything else around us. We'll see, in fact, it's kind of completely reversed. So, every body occupying a place is in that place according to the manner of dimensive quantity, namely, inasmuch as it is commensurate or the same with the place according to its dimensive quantity. So, don't you just love Thomas Aquinas? Here's a book. This book has a certain dimensive quantity, right? It's this long by this tall by this wide. It's because of this dimensive quantity that the book is in this place where it is. Because the place that it's in is the same, it's commensurate with the dimensive quantity of the book. So Thomas thinks of place as a kind of container. The book is in this place right here because it's contained. Its dimensive quantity is contained by a commensurate dimensive quantity. And if I move it over here, it's now in this place. It's contained in this dimensive quantity. Right? So the dimensive quantity of the place is commensurate, the same as the dimensive quantity of the book, which means, here's the point for what we're looking at. To be in a place, a thing has to be present by its dimensive quantity. So, an angel has no dimensive quantity. My body has dimensive quantity. It's extended in space. Head up here, feet down there, arms out here. An angel doesn't have a body. And so an angel has no dimensive quantity. It's not extended in space. And so an angel is not properly in a place. Think about that, right? An angel is not properly in a place because what makes something in a place is its dimensive quantity. So he says again, every body occupying a place is in that place according to the manner of its dimensive quantity, namely, inasmuch as it is commensurate with the place according to its dimensive quantity. Now watch. Hence, it remains that Christ's body is not in this sacrament as in a place, but after the manner of substance. That is to say, in the way in which a substance is contained by dimensions. So whatever we mean by the Eucharist, it's not in a place. I should say this more carefully. Christ's body is not present in a place in the Eucharist in the same way that a book is in a place or a cup is in a place. Now, at first that can sound very troubling. Isn't Christ present here on the altar or there in the tabernacle? And the answer is yes. But this shouldn't bother us. It should somewhat seem natural that Christ isn't present merely as a book is present. Christ's body isn't present merely as a cup is present. That would be, in a sense, all too ordinary. Christ's presence is utterly unique in this way. Right? So let's see what Thomas has to say about this. Hence it remains that Christ's body is not in this sacrament as in a place, but after the manner of substance. That is to say, in the way in which substance is contained by dimensions. Remember, a substance is contained by dimensions. The whole substance is here, the whole substance is here, the whole substance is in each part. Right? Before we move on, this also helps explain how Christ can be present in heaven and on that altar and in the tabernacle in the parish down the road and in the tabernacle on the other side of the world, and in fact in all of the tabernacles and altars of the world. How can Christ's body be in more than one place? Now, you'll remember from the reading, Martin Luther said that Christ's body has the properties of divinity, and so it can simply be ubiquitous. It because it's the body of God, his body can be everywhere. That's actually a Christological heresy. That's a Christological mistake to attribute the properties of one nature to the other. But this, in a sense, helps solve that problem of how Christ can be present in many places. Because Thomas will say, Christ is not present in a place in the normal way bodies are. Christ is present in a place, in one place, in his glorified body in heaven. His sacramental mode of being present is different and unique. Okay. Why? Because the substance of Christ's body succeeds or follows upon the substance of bread in this sacrament. We know that. Transubstantiation. The substance of bread is converted into the substance of Christ's body. Hence, as the substance of bread was not locally under its dimensions, but after the manner of substance, so neither is the substance of Christ's body. Okay, this is saying, Thomas is trying to understand, how is Christ's body present? And he's saying first, Christ's body, so this is the paper again, we can take the example of paper. According to substance, the dimensive quantity of paper, right, the dimensions of paper, doesn't put the substance of paper in this place rather than that place. The whole substance is present, The whole substance of paper is present in each part of the paper. So now he looks at the substance of bread. In a piece of bread, the whole substance of bread is present in every part. And he says, in a like way now, this is how it is with Christ's body. In the Eucharist, Christ's body is present after the manner of a substance. The whole substance of Christ's body is present in every part. So the dimensions of the bread don't somehow localize in only one place or in only one part the substance of Christ's body. But there's more. Even more, the substance of Christ's body is not the subject of those dimensions as was the substance of bread. Now he's taking this one step further, right? When you look at the bread or the paper, this paper is in this place because the substance, the substance of this paper is the subject of the dimensions of this paper. I'll say that again. Just as the substance of this paper is the subject in which whiteness inheres, or I would say the substance of paper is the subject of whiteness, so the substance of paper is the subject of its dimensive quantities, right? Accidents adhere in substances. The paper, the substance of paper, is the subject of its dimensive quantities. And because of that, this paper is in this place, according to its proper dimensive quantities. A piece of bread. The substance of bread is the subject of its own proper dimensive quantity. The substance of bread is that in which the accident of dimensive quantity inheres. Because the substance of bread has properly those dimensive quantities, it's in that place. Okay. However, we've already seen transubstantiation brings about this unique kind of presence in which the substance of Christ's body is present, but the accidents of bread and wine do not adhere in the body of Christ. Do you remember this from the last lecture or from the last class? The accidents of bread and wine remain without a proper subject, right? The accidents of bread and wine, the appearances of bread and wine, are not now adhering in the substance of Christ's body, right? Thomas says the accidents of bread and wine remain after consecration without a proper subject. So again, he says on the slide here, nevertheless, in the Eucharist, the substance of Christ's body is not the subject of the dimensions of bread and wine, as the substance of bread was. And therefore, the substance of bread was present locally in a place by reason of its dimensions, as normal things are. A thing is in a place because it's mediated to that place by its dimensions. Again, therefore, before consecration, the substance of the bread was there locally in a place by reason of its dimensions. The dimensions adhered in the substance of the bread naturally. One more time. The substance of the bread was there locally in a place before consecration by reason of its dimensions, because it, the bread, it was compared with that place through the medium of its own dimension. Or you could look at it this way. The substance is mediated to the place that it is in by its dimensions or dimensive quantity. Right? A substance has dimensions, and therefore it's in a place. But now, if you're thinking ahead, you can see where Thomas is going. After the consecration, the substance of Christ's body is not under its proper dimensions, and therefore it's not in a place in the same way other bodies are. This is what he says. But the substance of Christ's body, after consecration, the substance of Christ's body is compared with that place through the medium of foreign dimensions, the dimensive quantity, the dimensions of bread and wine don't adhere in Christ's body. The substance of Christ's body is compared with that place through the medium of foreign dimensions, so that on the contrary, that is different from every other body that you encounter, the proper dimensions of Christ's body, right? The proper dimensions of Christ's body, which are present by natural concomitance, the proper dimensions of Christ's body are compared with the place through the medium of substance, which is contrary to the notion of a located body. So it would look like this instead. Right, go back on the bottom here. In normal bread before the consecration, the substance of bread is mediated to the place by its dimensions. But after consecration, it's the other way around. The dimensions of Christ's body are mediated to the place by its substance, right? Okay, now you've hit, by the way, at this point right here, the high point, the most difficult point of Eucharistic theological philosophy, right? I think this is by far the hardest part of our course. Again, because it's almost impossible to form a mental picture. It's almost impossible to imagine, because everything around us, like this cup, is in a place because its dimensive quantities adhere in its substance. And so this substance is present in this place according to its dimensive quantity. But Thomas again says the Eucharist is completely different in its mode of presence. Christ's dimensions are present, but after the manner of substance. They're mediated to the place through the substance. It's completely background. And so he says, hence, in no way is Christ's body locally in this sacrament. We can say that Christ's body is present here on the altar, but only accidentally, because it's mediated through the species of bread and wine, which are truly present, located on the altar. There's this extra step of mediation. In a sense, Christ's presence is mediated to us through the accidents of bread and wine. So it is true to say, after all of this, Christ is present here on the altar, and Christ is present here in the tabernacle, but not in the same way that this cup is present here, or this paper is present here. Because here's the unique thing now. This cup is present here, and because of that, it can only be present here right now. It would be a contradiction to say that the cup is present here now and across the world at the same time. Christ's presence is different in that way. Because Christ is not present locally, like a cup or a piece of paper, Christ can be present substantially wherever the consecrated host is around the world at the same time. Okay. From this, it follows that Christ is present in this sacrament immovably, or we could say in an unchanging way. We don't change Christ in the sacrament. Rather, the substance of bread and wine are changed. So Thomas says in Article 6, when anything is one as to its subject, when anything is one subject, but manifold in its way or mode of being, there is nothing to hinder it, to stop it, from being moved, or let's think, changed, in one respect, and yet to remain at rest or unchanged in another. So if a thing is one thing, but it has different ways of being, if one thing has different ways of being, then it's perfectly possible for that one thing to be changed in one way, but to remain unchanged in another. And he gives an example. Just as it's one thing for a body, say, a piece of paper, to be white, and it's another thing for it to be large. Right before, this paper was large. Hence, it can be moved as to its whiteness or changed according to its whiteness, and yet continue unchanged as to its magnitude or size. Or I'll give you another example. We'll do the opposite example. This paper is both white and has this size. It's one in subject, but manifold in being, right? So this paper can be changed in size and yet remain unchanged in its whiteness. Okay, so that's the principle. Now he applies that to the Eucharist. In Christ, being in himself and being under the sacrament are not the same thing. Remember, this was the problem for the early Eucharistic controversies with Pascasius Radbertus and Ratramnus, with Berengarius, right? They didn't have this distinction of modes of being of the one Christ. In Christ, being in himself in glory in heaven and being under the sacrament are not the same thing. They're different modes of being of the one Christ. Because when we say that he is under the sacrament, we express a kind of relationship to this sacrament. He's present sacramentally, under the appearance of bread and wine. That's different than his natural mode of being. According to this being, then, in the sacrament, Christ is not moved locally of himself, but only accidentally, because Christ is not present in this sacrament as in a place. So when I move the paper, I'm simply moving the paper in itself. Thomas is saying here, when we move the host, we're not moving Christ around in heaven, right? We're moving the species of bread and wine which mediate to us Christ's substantial presence. So when we move the host, we're not moving Christ himself, but only accidentally, right? Because Christ is not present in the sacrament the same way that other bodies are in a place. Now he talks about movement. The same is true of all change. Anytime that the host is somehow changed, we're not changing Christ. When I chew the host in my mouth, Christ is not therefore in his natural body chewed. We should know this, right? If, God forbid, we drop the host, And God forbid someone accidentally steps on the host. Christ in his natural body is not therefore stepped on. Now, saying that, we all know we have to take the utmost care of the sacred species, of the host, right? Because of this, we don't get careless, right? That's not what I'm saying. Don't misunderstand me. But Christ is not changed by what happens in the Eucharist. So he says, what is not in a place is not moved locally. What is not in a place is not moved of itself locally, but only according to the motion of the subject in which it is. Right. So somewhere there's an example of a person in a boat. When the boat is moved, the person is moved accidentally. It's somewhat like that. When we move the host, we're properly moving the species of bread and wine, under which then Christ is present substantially. Hence, it is clear that Christ, strictly speaking, that is in himself, is immovably or unchangeably in this sacrament. And that goes for the cessation of the real presence as well. Someone had asked this question on one of the discussion boards. When does the presence of Christ end or cease? Well, this seems to be a change as well. Is this a change in Christ that the Eucharist at some point stops being his presence? And he says, no, this also is not a change in Christ. He says, in the same way, neither is it moved or changed of itself according to the being which it has in this sacrament. So Christ's being is not changed in this sacrament. See? Christ's being is not changed in the sacrament. In the same way, neither is it moved or changed of itself according to the being which it has in this sacrament by any change whatever. As, for instance, that it ceases to be under this sacrament. So he says, at some point, Christ ceases or stops being present in this sacrament. Is that a change in the being of Christ? And he says, no. Because whatever possesses unfailing existence of itself cannot be the principle of failing. If something cannot fail to exist, well, then it can't be what fails to exist. But when something else fails, when something else ceases to be, then that thing ceases to be in it. For instance, just as God, whose existence is unfailing and immortal, God ceases to be in some corruptible creature because such corruptible creature ceases to exist. So for instance, God is present to my cat. Right? God is present to all things. But when my cat dies and is buried in the ground and no longer exists, then God is not present to my cat. We all know this. This makes sense. But that's not a change in God. Right? When God ceases to be with my dead cat, that's not a change in God, but in the cat. Now, this applies to the Eucharist. And in this way, since Christ is unfailing and incorruptible in his being, he ceases to be under this sacrament, not because he ceases to be, it's not a change in him or by some local movement or change of his own, but only by the fact that the sacramental species cease to exist. So whenever the species of bread or wine, whenever the appearances of bread and wine cease to exist by digestion or by corruption, then the presence of Christ stops existing in them as well. But again, the point is, this is a change in the species of bread and wine, not in Christ. Okay, so a couple of points. I think that's the last slide. A couple of points. One, I didn't do any lectures on the Reformers, the Protestant Reformers, or Trent, because I thought the material from Feingold was very clear. What I am asking you to do is to read the 6 pages or so from the Council of Trent, because I think it's good to actually read the primary text. And then there is a section in Feingold's book. Sorry, let me grab the book. There is a section in Feingold's book that you should review after you read Trent itself. There's a section called, in the chapter on the Council of Trent, there's a section called Summary of the Principal Truths on the Real Presence Defined by the Council of Trent, and he lists 6 points. So after you read the Council of Trent itself, session 13, which I posted, go and review those 6 points from Feingold. And that should be sufficient for the Protestant Reformers and Trent. The other thing I wanted to explain more is some 20th century theories of transsignification and transfinalization. And I thought for that I would have you read a brief paper that I wrote, which is also posted on Populi. So I'll ask you to read that as well, rather than if I did a lecture, I would just read it to you, and I don't need to do that. So you can read that. I've also posted on Populi a much longer article about this lecture, about Christ's unique presence, and that he's not present as in a place. It's an article I wrote for a journal a few years ago. That is not required reading. It's only if you're interested in this. Okay. I'll finally say, if this was confusing, please don't worry too much. This is, again, perhaps the most difficult thing we'll deal with. What's important to understand here is that one of the ways the difficulties of the early Eucharistic controversies, one of the ways those problems were solved was by the understanding that Christ's mode of presence in the Eucharist is different than his mode of presence in his natural body. That's the most important thing to gain out of all of this, that Christ's mode of presence in the Eucharist is utterly unique, unlike the mode of presence of any other body that we encounter. So if some of this was confusing, again, don't worry. We're going to move on from here and look at the sacrifice of the Mass next week. Again, please use the discussion boards if you'd like to ask more specific questions about anything that we've discussed.